Yes, that would involve the first.
Okay, then why would that be relevant in this proceeding?
I'm really not sure what this proceeding is about. I filed a motion to have Kathy removed.
Pardon me, please complete.
I have withdrawn my objection for the leave to sell because you made it clear that the only thing that you could rule on in that hearing was it for fair market value. That wasn't in my objection. You said everything in that, all those addresses, everything had to be addressed in there. Title to the land, it's still being in my mother's name, liens, all that has to be cleared up before they can sell that property. That petition was presented before Judge Woolley. She would have, that should have been immediately rejected because that property still hasn't been put into the estate.
There's a lot of law involved there, Ms. Nichols, that it would be very helpful, I think, if you had an attorney to help explain some of that background. The motion has been withdrawn. Your objection to the sale has been withdrawn. I did indicate that it's not the position of this court, nor within the power of this court, to clear title of any liens that are filed against the real estate. I understand the deed was set aside that went into your mother's estate, if I remember correctly. So with that, I understand that your only evidence through Ms. Woolley is for that first matter. The fact that she sat as a judge and signed some other things, she's recused herself, and the personal knowledge really comes into play as being a requirement for her to testify today. So is there anything else you can tell me she can contribute to this hearing?
She could contribute a lot to this hearing.
What else?
I have subpoenaed people that are in this courtroom. Shouldn't they be, should we be talking about this in front of some witnesses?
I've had no motion for any witnesses to be removed, so you certainly would have been able to do that. Does anyone else wish to be heard on the motion to quash subpoena for Judge Woolley? I'm trying to see, Ms. Nichols, what there is a division of the bench and the trial process, and I want to give you every opportunity to present your case. However, what I've heard is that her knowledge involves the prior 103 case and not the current, I believe, 156 case. And unless there's some delving into case 103, I think the motion to quash is appropriate. And I'm going to sign an order that does quash that subpoena. If you've got some specific evidence beyond 103 that extends into 106, I will certainly be glad to consider.
They're both on this.
The fact that you've styled it in the top of the pleading really doesn't mean anything.
Your Honor, I'm not the one that's done this, so.
Okay. Motion to quash is granted. If y'all would present an order, Mr. Posey, please.
Yeah. I'll get one to you soon.
Okay. And specifically within that order, we need to make some recitation that the presentation of the person making the subpoena, Ms. Nichols, was the matters were limited to the alleged forgeries within 103. I have heard nothing else under which she presents the position that Judge Willis should be here under 156. Okay, I had the list next as on the motion for removal and accounting, and I think Mr. Talent perhaps has the procedural objection to make in that instance.
I do, Your Honor.
May I be excused?
Yes, sir.
Nice to meet you. Judge, this is a motion that was filed for the removal of Kathy Pruitt Freeman as a personal representative of the estate. Mr. Pruitt, request for accounting and reports of the estate both for the current and previous estate number. And just as a preliminary matter, I don't know how my client could file an accounting for the previous estate number where she never served as personal representative. Just to kind of bring the court up to speed, we have provided an accounting from the beginning of this estate up through and including November 14th, 2017. And through that time period, there have been no expenditures and no disbursements. I just wanted to bring you up to speed on that. The only difference is that the estate was successful in its request to have the deed set aside, as the court's already recognized. And we have taken steps, Your Honor, to have a certified copy of that order recorded. But that's a title issue, which of course this court doesn't deal with. But just so everybody's up to speed on that.
And I think the language was may record.
It's exactly right, Your Honor. There's nothing required, as it was a may record. And frankly, that was done because we were hoping to be able to continue to negotiate. But here's where we are. We're trying to sell the property. The reason I think this is procedurally improper, Your Honor, is because to revoke my client's letters of administration, which is what this is, when you remove a personal representative, what you're going to be doing is revoking her letters of administration. That was done in this case by motion, and that's not proper. OCGA 53-755 requires a petition in order to do that. Of course, a petition has to be personally served, and that was eventually accomplished in this case. My client was served with the petition on the 29th day of November, but it wasn't a petition and it wasn't verified. And in probate court, any petition, and this requires a petition, every petition filed in the probate court shall be verified by the oath of the petitioner. That's OCGA 53-11-8. Part of the, so that's the first basis. It was supposed to be a petition, it wasn't a petition, it was supposed to be verified, it wasn't verified. We're here because the court set this down as a day when you were gonna hear all the issues that were involved with regard to bond and with regard to that petition for leave to sell, which of course is the objection of that's now been withdrawn. The other reason this is procedurally improper at this point is because if a petition had been filed, and if it had been verified as it was supposed to be, OCGA 53-755 also requires then a citation. So the way that happens is once you get a petition, which you did not get in this case, then the probate court reviews the petition and makes an initial determination as to its sufficiency. Does it raise issues that would require the removal of my client? Once that's been done, then the court issues a citation directly to my client, with which my client is to be personally served, telling her to come to court and say why the relief requested should not be given. In other words, the court, if it reviews a verified petition, which was never filed in this case, the court then reviews it, says, all right, if we meet the threshold burden, then I am to cite you, and it says the court shall cite the personal representative to answer the charge.
But I'm sorry, what code section is that?
That's OCGA 53-755. There's no letter. It's just the code section just begins with that paragraph. So it's 53-755. Once that investigation has begun, then it's within the court's discretion. I mean, this is a discretionary issue, of course, at the end of the day, whether or not the court wants to remove a personal representative. And we would submit, the substantive arguments are plentiful, of course, in this case, but we're not even here properly. Ms. Nichols has not done the things that she is required to do under the law to bring this issue to the court, because we never had the verified petition to begin with, which of course led the court to not issue the citation to show cause, because you didn't have the pleadings that you were supposed to have before you would have issued that citation to show cause. So that's our procedural objection, Your Honor. Here's what I think should happen. I think that we should get to you the order on the petition for leave to sell. This is a motion to dismiss this motion because it's not even a proper pleading under the probate code. And then we can go forward and we can deal with the title issues on the property, and we can finally move forward and try and get this estate closed. Judge, I was looking back, we started this over 3 years ago is when my client filed her petition for letters of administration in this case, and we're really ready to wrap it up. And that's certainly what we want to try and do. And I think that would be the most efficient way and, frankly, the proper legal way to do it, considering what we have in front of us. Judge, I have copies, if the court would like to have it, I have copies of each of those code sections. I know the court may be looking at the code book now. So I'll just hold these unless the court wants to see any of them.
All right, sir. Excuse me, Ms. Nichols, give me just a moment, please, ma'am. Okay, Ms. Nichols, do you have anything in response? Understand the objection is that the form of what you have presented and filed is incorrect according to Mr. Talent. Should have been by petition and it was required to be verified, which is of course sworn or affirmed before a notary or other appropriate officer. So if that correctly summarizes his position, what is your response to that?
Well, it really doesn't matter what I file in this court because you're going to find, whether I'm an attorney or not, there's going to always be something wrong with it. I'm trying to have my day in court, which you told me that you were going to lay the groundwork to do. When I filed that objection, then therefore this hearing today should have never been, we shouldn't be here today for this. He's exactly right. But you put me in a position that I had to file something. You want to know everything filed within 15 days before this hearing, which we shouldn't even be having because I withdraw my objection. So I've had many attorneys involved in this who I have tried so hard. Mr. Talent's right. This should have been handled. How long have you been involved with this, Mr. Talent?
I think I first spoke to Ms. Freeman probably in September of 2014.
Yes, and on your billing for your motion for summary judgment, you had already...
Let's conform to responding to what his argument is, Ms. Nichols, please, which is you did it in an improper way. You didn't do it by petition, it was not verified. So if you could please limit yourself to that at this point.
Everything I've ever done has not been the right way. When I've had an attorney, when I haven't had an attorney. So if we're not here to hear the objection, we're done, then I can file the proper paperwork.
Anything further?
I mean, if that's what he's arguing, you're talking about setting aside a deed. That's how you fix this. As everyone says, I've inherited a mess, basically. It's what I've inherited. Why didn't he do that in the very beginning?
Anything further?
No, Your Honor.
Let me go to point two before I go back to point one. Ms. Nichols, do you have the accounting received as prepared and presented by Mr. Talent and Ms. Freeman?
I do, Your Honor.
Have you had a chance to review that?
Briefly.
Any objections or questions?
Yes. Kathy has about $3,000 worth of artwork. I have a list of those. And the artist has since passed, so I have a list of what all that was worth. You gave some of that away, I believe. But I also requested, I think, what is owed. We need to know where we stand.
Well, that has been presented. That was your part of your motion. And it appears that they have attempted to respond to the prior order of Judge Campbell, and they have done it at the hearing today. So do you have any, excuse me, Do you have any objection as to the filing and acceptance of this?
If my motion is invalid, then this is invalid. So I'm not.
When you say this, I don't know what you mean.
The annual return. If this motion wasn't filed properly, then none of this matters, correct?
But I want to be certain that you have a copy of the inventory that they bring up that you're entitled to. I want to be sure that that is received by you.
I have a copy, but I don't agree with this, so.
Okay. Well, it's, the court finds that it has been properly presented and properly filed, meaning the inventory. Let's address Mr. Talent's procedural motion. And Ms. Nichols, please understand that the courtroom and the law, and as the facts and the testimony of the law pours through the court, it's very important that there be a format that's accepted, that everybody understands the rules. And when this is being accomplished, everybody has a right to present within a framework that is a known framework. There are reasons that the law is written the way it is. It protects folks. It allows them adequate time to respond, adequate time to present their case, and that's the goal of the whole system. But it appears to me that Mr. Talon is correct that under this 53-755, which I had read before I got here this morning, revocation of letters of personal representative, it says upon the petition of any person having an interest in the estate, which you certainly are for your mother's estate, and it must be verified. And I think the other formalities that Mr. Town recited would be appropriate, because all this kind of blows up in the last two or three days with the motion to dismiss or revoke her letters and the motion to do these things. And I respect that you feel very earnestly that it is properly filed and upon good facts, but understand again, it's got to fit within the framework of the way the law requires it to be. You're at great disadvantage not to have an attorney, and I, of course, encourage you at our first hearing to have an attorney. But I do think this motion is appropriate, that your motion be dismissed. And I will sign an order if you have one drawn reciting the appropriate authority.
I do not, Your Honor, but I'll have one prepared. I'll get one prepared, get one to Judge. We also did not find that what we had, the standard form, I apologize for not saying, the standard form order on the petition for leave to sell, but we'll have that brought to you immediately, Judge.
I think that's a good idea that we could perhaps locate that and get Ms. Nichols to sign off on that today. Is there a way we could do that?
I can probably have it done via email, Your Honor. I'll see if I can get somebody in the clerk's office to allow me to send it to them. I know I can pull it up and have it prepared, and then I'll get somebody in the clerk's office to send it to them. I don't know that Ms. Nichols would be interested in signing off on anything that I would prepare, but with her objection being withdrawn, it's simply okay. Going to say this is the amount that's to be sold for, this is the description of the real property as set forth in the petition.
And I think the form says no objection having been filed. We'll just, Ms. Nichols, it'll just be amended to say objection having been filed and withdrawn.
Right, I'll take care of that.
And with her approval, I will sign an order on that basis.
Your Honor, can we just go over that petition before I sign anything on that?
It is simply an order.
No, it's the petition itself. We can go through everything on that objection.
Well, procedure.
The petition.
You tell me which document you're speaking of.
The petition for leave to sell that I filed an objection to.
Right.
Let's look at that petition and go over everything on there and look at my objection.
Well, you have withdrawn your objection. It no longer exists, and that order will be signed allowing the sale. That was your choice, and you could file that withdrawal.
Then why are we here today?
Because you, several documents were filed. I wanted to have a final hearing on this, and you filed a motion to to revoke the letter for have Ms. Freeman removed, and you also file for an inventory. And I wanted to be sure and have a hearing today to have those matters addressed. And you do have an inventory, and the motion to have Ms. Freeman removed has been addressed as well. That was the reason for the hearing, because you had filed those motions.
So you've dismissed my motion to have her removed?
On the procedural grounds that Mr. Talent has presented, I think it's appropriate.
Accepted my withdrawal?
Certainly.
I said we're done, right?
As far as I'm concerned, as far as the court's concerned, we're done. Is there anything further?
No, sir. Your Honor, we'll present those orders to you in a format. I'll certainly provide a copy to Ms. Nichols. If the court finds them to be appropriate, we just ask that the court sign them at that point.
All right, sir. All right. Thank you all for your attendance.
Does the court want us just to, since I mean I need to mail them to Ms. Nichols, does the court want me to mail them to the court as well?
Sure.
Okay. We'll take care of that, Judge. Thank you.
Do you have my office address? It has a rather lengthy route to come through the probate court and then to me.
Would it be okay if we were to just confirm it, Judge?
Sure.
If you'll go ahead, we'll...
My address is P.O. Box 1556 Cornelia 30531.
Thank you, Your Honor. We'll take care of that immediately.
Thank you. Okay, Ms. Nichols, I'll be signing the order allowing the sale, which you have consented to, and I will be signing the motion dismissing your motion on those procedural grounds granted. And Ms. Nichols needs to have adequate opportunity to look through the inventory, but at least show in the order that the inventory was presented to her.
Yes, sir. I'll take care of that.
Okay. All right. We are adjourned.
May we be excused, Your Honor?
Certainly. The original file, I've just got my copies, the original file said in the first office.
Do you need the style? The style? Is that what you need, the style?
I think the spellings, the proper spellings. Yes, that'll help very much, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And you can just keep that if you want to.
Thank you, I appreciate that.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry, Ms. Matthews, you said 121-20.
121 even.
121 even.
Yes. Okay.